pleasure for me to be with you today. It's a pleasure to be with you and Laetitia to speak about what is important for both of us, which is the fact that now we should have in mind that the world is at really at a crossroad, and that each of us in our different capacities, professors, writers, politicians, heads of organization, students, we must think about the future. It's obvious for the students that they have to think about the future, because almost all of you, I hope all of you will be there in 2080, which is tomorrow. As the teachers which are here, their students will be here in 2080, which means that they have an action that will have a consequence on 2080. And if I look at you students as potential teachers, the students you may have will be active in 2110 or 20, which means quite a lot of time ahead. Therefore, even if we don't want to take care of that long-term, long-term is in this room. And if we don't do today something that is useful for them or you, we are not going to prepare the world for survival. First, it's clear that each of us in our individual life, we have to think about long term. There is no possible life if we only focus on what I'm going to do tonight. Am I going to have a dinner? Am I going to have a movie? Am I going to have to see my friend or my girlfriend or whatever? If we just focus on tonight or tomorrow, there is no possibility of planning a course of education, savings, project of any kind, and the world would be just a succession of instant. And actually, it's exactly what is happening, because the world is more and more pure successions of instants, where no one is taking care of more than tomorrow. Even tomorrow is very late, because the world is organized more and more in the feeling that the only thing that that count is me now, and the rest doesn't matter. It's organized like that through a lot of different dimensions, mainly the fact that we consider that we are bound to be free, and that one dimension of freedom is to be selfish. If I'm free, I'm selfish, I'm right, allowed to be selfish, and then I'm allowed to do whatever I want. And if we organize the world like that, and if it's exactly what is happening around us, if you see what is happening through the decision of politicians, for instance, we take their decisions only taking into account the last public poll, or the media that organize their behavior according to the number of followers we have, or the companies that decide the products on the number of clients we have tomorrow, not thinking about long term. Whatever happened, if we do that in our private life, nothing will be seriously organized, and the world will be and is today going in a direction where all this elements of short-termism is leading to a catastrophe. If we look at the world as it is today, we see a lot of dimensions which are the consequence of this focus on selfish short-term decision. Public debt is a consequence of the fact that we don't care about what the next generation are going to pay. Environment is a consequence of the fact that we don't care about who will be in charge of repairing it. Demography is declining because we don't care. We selfishly prefer to live without too much burden of children than to create the conditions for the next generation to be numerous enough to survive. And if we continue like that, there will be less and less children, And when people in this room, they may be at the end of the day the last human beings on Earth, which will be a catastrophe because at the end of their life it will be a nightmare because there will be nobody to replace them, nobody to finance their pensions, nobody to make the system work when they will be too tired and will be a real wild world. This is something that may happen if we continue on that direction. One of the reason why we do lack that today is, as I said, because we focus on short term. And we focus on short term because we are in a world which is more and more a world of selfishness, which is the consequence of a very important value that we have chosen, which is the value of individual freedom, which is a value that is so important that many people die for it. When we build democracy, when we build market democracy, when we build the whole society that we love to live in. But if we go too far into that direction, market democracy means pure decision taken on the instant preferences that we may have. And then we lead to a catastrophe where we are and where we will be more and more. And where the next generations, which means the generation in this room, we'll be facing in 20 years. Therefore, it's obvious that one way or another, long-term will win, or long-term will try to take his revenge against us. Can do it differently, in different means. One way will be to say, well, market democracy failed. We did not succeed in organizing a world that is able to create well-being for us, and we need a world that gives a meaning to things. And that meaning is appearing today through the birth of new ideologies, which are fundamentalism, not only Muslim fundamentalism, but also Christian fundamentalism, Jewish fundamentalism, Buddhism, etc., which are a way of getting out of a world of uncertainty, precarity, fragility, short-termism that we are living. And don't forget that what is happening today around us is the answer to our own weakness. The second way of doing it will be to say, okay, we don't want to have a fundamentalism, but we need to have something stable, and that could be another kind of totalitarian regime. We had a lot of totalitarian regime in the past, and it's not because of in Europe we didn't face totalitarian regime in the last 60 years that it's over forever. It's not true. If we continue to have a world that is not able to face and to answer to questions such as the one I mentioned, environment, public debt, education, precarity, social mobility, etc., something else will happen. And if something else doesn't happen, people that don't like what is happening in this world will quit, will go elsewhere, will go where they have another life, and the country where these weaknesses are growing will be weaker and weaker more and more, and something will occur. It's why it's so important to try to think about, can we create a world where we save the best of the two worlds? One, the best of individual freedom, which is what we love and what we could not imagine to live without. Freedom to move, freedom to choose, freedom to vote, freedom to choose the products we consume, freedom to work wherever we want, freedom to travel, freedom to whatever. But not all dimensions of freedom, not freedom to betray, not freedom to be disloyal, not freedom to lose any interest in the next generations, not freedom to take any interest in the past generations, and try to find a balance with it. It's a very difficult challenge. It's what we call positive economy. It means an economy where we will collectively take into account in any of our decisions the interest of next generations. Imagine a world where 20 years ago we will have taken into account the interest of the world of today. If we had done that, and if we have done that properly with no mistakes, which is another question, because we can take care of next of the future, but make mistakes, and that's facts of life. But we could have been today in a much better world. We could have said, okay, 20 years ago we could have seen, well, in 20 years from now we'll have a problem of demography, and then we should do more in terms of family policy to improve the demography in our countries. In 20 years from now, if we continue like that, we'll have a huge public debt that will be impossible to pay back. And then be cautious, don't spend too much, and don't do that. And we'll be in much better position, especially in Italy or in France, because of that. If 20 years from now we'll have seen that the world was going to a mess in terms of environment and climate change, we'll maybe have done much more in terms of energy saving, development of technology for solar energy, of collaborative economy, new technologies linked to that, etc. So if we had in mind 20 years ago what is the danger of today, the world will be in much better situation today. Which means that if we don't do what must be done today, we know for sure that the world will be a nightmare in 30 years from now. A nightmare in terms of population, a nightmare in terms of environment, a nightmare in terms of frustration, inequalities, weakening of rule of law. We know that, it's clear, it's obvious, the nightmare is coming. But of course we prefer to say, we keep on preferring to say, well, I will die before, and I don't care. Second, if I don't die before, I will quit, I will go elsewhere, I will go in Australia, or I will go in US, or in a country where life would be better. Third, it will not touch me. Maybe the world will be touched, but not me. Exactly when someone is facing a bad news. When the doctor gives a bad news to someone, the first feeling is, not me, not now, I don't care. That's a sign of rejection of bad news. We don't like bad news. And we are a world surrounded by bad news that we don't want to hear. That doesn't mean that we have to give up. It's clear that we are not far from a moment where things are going to be very difficult to manage. In 30 years from now, if I make the list of what could be the world in terms of terrorism, spreading of weapons, new technologies that can destroy even the nature of mankind, the development of frustration, the manipulations by robots, the monitoring of people by technology of surveillance, frustrations, etc., etc. The world can be a nightmare, and there's more than 80 chances out of 100 that we are going through in the next 30 years a huge war. That's obvious. If we continue like that, this is going to happen. We can still prevent it. The only way to prevent it is to think about it, and not to say it's a nightmare, I will try just to escape and go to the moon or whatever to avoid it, but to fight. And to fight means first understand the future, understand the different consequences of where we are going, and second, try to act. Act means different things. That means, first in our personal life, I'm always in mind what I do today, what are the consequences of what I do today on the next 20 years, for me and for the others. It's a difficult question, but if I behave badly with the environment, I produce problems for the next 20 years. But if I have that in mind, then I can play my role just as a selfish individual in my private behavior. More than that, in my private behavior, I can do more about it if I decide to work or to study or to participate either in my job or out of my job in activities that are useful for the next generations or for the world in 20 years. Which means that I can spare times and invest in environment, spare times and invest in education of people, because if people are not educated and they are going to be frustrated and they are going to be look for revenge, I can do things for improving the transparency of a society. I can do things to improve the quality of life of women, which are in poor positions everywhere in the world, etc., etc. There are so many things that each of us we can do, and not only looking at the cat show tonight on TV. A lot of things that we can do. If we don't do it, then the world will go to the worst. Of course, there are also a lot of things that can be done collectively, and that is what we should be part of the political decision process in the next decade. In order to understand that, we have launched worldwide this movement of a positive economy, which is, after a long process of thinking, the gathering of many, many people around the world which are doing that without even knowing that they work together. They work together for the future, but they don't know they do it. They work on environment, they work on education, they work on social impact, they work on microfinance, they work on environment, they work on health. Well, they work on a lot of different activities. Being altruist because they have understood that being altruist is the best way to be rationally selfish, efficiently selfish. Because if you are altruist, then you create a world that would be better for yourself. They do that, and they don't even know that a lot of other people do that. And we have decided to try to gather them together, not only to think together, but to realize that we are not alone. As the song says, you are not the only one. And to make a long story short, we have done that with many people in France, around, and after that around the world, in Italy, where we have another meeting of that kind next April in St. Patrignano, where all of you are welcome. We'll try to gather a lot of experience of people in many different countries, in many different activities, engineers, CEOs, NGOs, companies, government officials, people of goodwill that work having in mind, do what I do is useful for next generations. That means that for that we need to have a theory of the future. What can we say about the future? And second, a theory of reforms of the behavior of individuals and organizations in order to know to improve the future. A theory of future is very difficult. There is no real clear theory of the future. Many things have been said since 5,000 years about the future. And it's very, very difficult to be sure of what we may say. I say before some things about the future, but many people have tried. Prophets have tried. People are looking in the signs in the ends or stars or whatever have tried to understand the future. Are not very efficient. And since the beginning of the 20th century, many attempts have been made to understand the future, sometimes quite accurately, sometimes with a huge amount of mistakes. But that doesn't mean that we make mistakes. That's not because we make mistakes in trying to understand the future that we shouldn't try. It's not because I very often use that metaphor that if you drive a car at night on a bumpy road, even if your lights are weak, it's better try to use them, because even if you have a small hint of what is ahead, it's better than not to have any. Therefore, it's important to try to understand the future, even if it's very difficult. And it's true that we don't have a lot of techniques today to understand the future. There are rational way and there are intuitive way of understanding the future. There are a lot of techniques. The meditation is providing techniques, music is providing techniques, and I can spend a lot of time explaining you the different techniques to provide information about the future, but at least we know a lot about the future. We know a lot about demography, we know a lot about technology, we know a lot about geopolitics, we know a lot about ideology, And that's enough to say a lot about the future of the world. Let's just take an example about demography. Today we are 7 billion. We know that in 2050 we are going to be 9 billion. We know that out of these 9 billion, it will be not anymore half of it in cities, but two-thirds in cities. It will be not anymore an average age of 25, but an average age of something like 36. World population is aging. It will be also a world where it will be, we will have less Italians, more French, less Germans, not a growing number of Americans, a declining number of Chinese, an increasing number of Indians, more than anything else, a huge increase of the numbers of Africans. Out of 2 more billions, one will be in Africa. African population will go from 1 billion to 2 billion. And in 2050, in 2100, will be 4 billion Africans. And as you know, in Italy, more than anywhere else, Africa is our backyard. If we don't do something for Africa, Africa will be a threat. If we do something for Africa, Africa will be a trump for us. By the way, in 2050, there will be less citizens of the United States than citizens of Nigeria. It's tomorrow, 2050. It's tomorrow. I can add on and on things that are almost certain in terms of demography. For instance, we know that as of today, the balance between men and women in the history of mankind has always been equal because of by random. But today, as we can control birth through abortion and echography, etc., in almost all civilization, it's better to have a boy than a girl. Therefore, the imbalance is growing. And as of today, there is an imbalance of 100 million girls in Asia. This imbalance will grow. This is a sign of violence, because the imbalance is a danger. Other example of figures that we know today, less than 220 million people are living in another country than the country they were born, which is not a lot out of 7 billion. But if we continue on the trend of today, in 2050 it will be 1.5 billion people living in another country they were born. Huge amount of movement. Not only north to south, but north to north, south to south, north to south. Huge amount of movement. Can you imagine that world where we are going to live, where you are going to live, with this huge movement of population, with this population living longer, with less people in age to work, for people having decided not to work anymore after 60 or 55 or whatsoever? Nightmare, impossible. Simply through demography we see it's impossible. If I add the consequence of the fact that being not 7 billion but 9 billion, we'll have to spend more on energy, we'll have to spend more on food, we'll have to spend more on ground, impossible, except if we find technological answer. For instance, we know that the climate is influenced by the emission of CO2, and if we want to avoid that the temperature of the world goes more than increased warm by 2 degrees in the 21st century, we need to reduce the consumption of energy, which means that some years ago people were saying, well, we don't have enough energy, and then we should know that energy is scarce. Today we know it's exactly the contrary. We know that we have more energy that we should spend. If we want to avoid to put on the atmosphere the CO2, which is lethal in terms of climate change, we need to decide now, this year, that we will not use, never use 65% of the coal that is known, 50% of the gas that is known, and 35% of oil that is known. Can you imagine mankind deciding, we have it, we decide not to use it? Of course not. Of course not. And therefore, another problem is going to come, which is the increase of temperature, which is going to be good in some dimensions, because the climate of Canada and Siberia will change, which will improve the quality of life in this part of the world, but huge change in population and level of sea, etc. This will happen, except if we hope that technology will provide answers, and that's another element where we know many things that are coming and where forecast is not so difficult. We know that technology is going to appear and changing a lot in IT. Digital economy is known, but digital economy is known for what is obvious. We speak about cloud, we speak about web processing, but this is just tomorrow, not the day after tomorrow. It's obvious. Many other things are coming in terms of nanotechnologies, in terms of biotechnologies, in terms of neurosciences, which means that in less than 20 years, which is tomorrow, we'll be able to have a mixture of animals and human beings. It's already almost possible. We know that we can put some elements of human genome in some animals and have modified animals, as of now, that exist. And we know that we can also create artificial organs to improve the quality of life or to increase this lifespan of many individuals. A lot of people believe that many of you in this room will live more than 150 years. Is it a better world to live in, a world where everyone will live 150 years? Why not? Many people believe that a person that will live more than 1,000 years is already born. What world is it? Is it a... Why not? But how can we think about this world? Have we even begin to think about what it means? In terms of organization of life, relations between different generations, how much we work, nobody thinks about it. About death, what means death in such a world? If you look at how people organize their and death and life and immortality is the key question for mankind since millenniums. How do you organize that? For religions? Through artificial virtual cemeteries? Look at on internet, you will find that a lot of people begin to have virtual cemeteries. Vertigo of ideas are coming about it. What to do with what we are, what we will be, are we going to let an image, many things happen. Who think about it? It's very important not to let us taken by this evolution, because if we let that happen, a lot of people will say no to that. And then we'll have what happened very often in the history of mankind. We say no to the future. We say the past was best. And when in a civilization people begin to say the past was better or was best, then we know that totalitarianism is around the corner. When people begin to say the past is better, the worst is coming. And that happened many times. That happened at the end of the 18th century, at the end of the 19th century, at the beginning of the 20th century, and you know that in French and in Italian. Civilization. We know that even as we know today, look at around the world, we see a lot of people who say, well, the Islamic world was better in the 8th century, Caliphate, it was the best. Let's go back to that. And we see that in many different dimensions. If we want to avoid that, we have not only to think about the future, and I just begin to give you some ideas of how to think again, the future, but we have also to try to know how to master the future. And the key question for tomorrow is, can we master the future without putting in place a totalitarian regime? Can we organize a civilization or society or a nation that will think about the future, try to influence it without jeopardizing too much the individual freedom? Because if I give a power to the next generations, that reduces my own power, and therefore I am not any more free as much as I want. If I say, for instance, I should not make too much public debt, therefore that means I should not spend too much. Take the example of Greece. It's quite clear that Greek citizens are can say, well, we want to have a decent salary, we want to have a decent economic system, we have a decent health system. Who can say no to that? Of course, yes. The only way to do it, unfortunately, is to borrow. Who is going to pay? Someone else. Who else? Next generations. Greek or non-Greek? That's another question. But if we give to the existing generation full power on their life, they will decide to do what is good for them and not take care for the future. And exactly the discussion which is at stake now in Greece. And either we face reality, which is that we cannot do more than what we can afford to do today. We should do it on a more rational, efficient, fair way and avoid that scandalous wealthy people are taking the money out of the country. That's another issue. But we cannot say, let's do what we want. We are a democracy. We are free. We want to decide. We want high minimum wage. It's up to us to decide. Nobody can avoid that, can prevent us to do it, except that we do it on the expense of next generations. And one day they have to pay. How to organize this balance? It's exactly the question that we try to face. One way to do it first is to raise the importance of thinking about the future. Discuss it. And it's fascinating to discuss the thinking of the future, the mistakes that have been done on forecasting the future. Many mistakes have been done, amazing mistakes have been done. And we should think about the mistakes that have been done on forecasting the future, not to say, okay, it's impossible to forecast the future, forget about it, but to improve the forecast. And universities are fundamental. We don't do a lot. We don't spend enough money, we don't spend enough research, we don't have enough brain focusing on what will be the future. In terms of technology, in terms of society, we don't have a lot. A lot of things come by surprise. Why? Why Daesh was surprised? Why everybody knew that Daesh was created in 2006? Nobody saw it. Why do a lot of issues appear on technologies that have not been thought about while it exists since a lot of time? Internet has been created in 1967, and a lot of people think even today that it's a new thing, Internet. It's not a new thing, more than 50 years ago. And many things of that kind should be discussed today in research centers, laboratories, in order to make better understanding of the future. It's very complex because there is a huge amount of interactions, there is a huge amount of difficult way of thinking, but something can be done. For instance, strangely enough, what was done in various, in more than 50 years ago, 40 years ago by the Club of Rome, was amazingly accurate. If you look at what the Club of Rome has forecast for 2030 in 1970, it's amazingly accurate in terms of lack of resources, environment, oil, etc. Amazingly accurate. In 2070, with a capacity of computing which was very, very small compared to what we have. A huge amount of things can be done today to have a better understanding of the future. If we don't do it, maybe it's because we don't want to do it. Because we have a lot of difficulties to understand that the world is a village and that we should think of the world as a nation. For instance, nobody knows exactly the GDP of the world. It's about 70,000 billion dollars. But it's not well known. We don't think the world as one. We don't. Very rarely, we don't have statistics of the world as one. We don't have economic theory of the world as one. We don't have a real vision of that. A lot. It's a huge agenda for research. In terms of technology, we don't have a lot of technology of energy savings. Huge amount of things can be done. We don't have a lot of data banks of best practice. Huge of best practice things are done to save energy by using solar energy, by using different techniques around the world, and many in Africa or in India, where huge amount of initiatives are taken, where is the data bank to save and exchange best practice of that? Nowhere. There is a best practice data for fiscal policies, yes, in OECD countries, but not best practice on energy savings, not best practice on preventions, on health, not best practice on education. We still train young people the same way, and we don't exchange ideas worldwide. A huge amount of things are still to be done to increase the exchange of experience at a world level and to understand that the world is a village, that the world should take care of the future. And what that being said, much more must be done in terms of giving incentives to develop actions for long term. Means universities focusing on long life training. I'm always, by the way, totally fascinated by the way that, by the fact that when you take a plane and that you spend 1 hour, 2 hours, 6 hours in a plane, you have a lot of videos, but not one video about learning. You can't learn anything in a plane. You cannot learn anything in a train. You cannot learn anything in many different time of your life where you should be in position to learn something. No. What is important in our world is try to help us avoid to think. Panem et circenses. Avoid to think. Not to think. That's why we run on a catastrophe. Then think, discuss the long term, exchange experience is something fundamental, and universities as for that. I'm very happy that the conference of the main deans of the university, Italian universities, are coming to San Patrignano to our forum, because this should be a focus. Long studies on long term, how to study long term, on all dimensions of long term. Many mistakes will be done, and 20 years from now, people will be ashamed of the mistakes they have done, but better to make a mistake than not to think about it. And second is, and after that, what is important is to find ways to build in the institutions the importance of long term. Because if we continue like that, we'll have a world which is more and more taking care of short term and not long term. We have built an index of what we call the positive index, which is the measurement of how much a nation is focusing on long term. And we have built that index for all the countries of OECD, and we measure this index since 2 years, probably the 3rd year we measure it. What is interesting is to see that the countries which are more interested in long term are, as we all know, country of Northern Europe. Can you imagine that Norway, for instance, is an amazing country that has one of the highest standard living in the world, that has oil more than we can imagine, but instead of spending the money they earn on oil, they put that on a fund and they forget it. And in this fund, as we speak, there is almost 1,000 billion euro. No one of these 1,000 billion euro is used for Norwegian citizens. Zero. It is used just for savings for next generations. In 100 years from now, when there will be no more oil, that's exactly what is at stake. They do exactly what should be done. They don't spoil the money for something which is just for today. That's why they are number one in terms of long-term thinking. Among the last one in different European countries are Italy. France is unfortunately not in good shape also, but why? Because we don't care about the future. We spend more than we earn. We don't make enough children. We don't have a family policy, etc., and all the things I said before. Then what is important is not only to say that countries are differently ranking in terms of positive action, but that globally, if we look at the world globally, the measurement of the positivity of the world is declining. The world is less and less positive year after year. The world is more and more focusing on short-term issues. That is going to lead to a catastrophe. Measurement is important because you cannot discuss something if you don't measure it. Measurement is a condition for discussion, for action. Second, action by individuals, and individuals means each of us. By the way, one of the most accepted conclusion by doctors is that there is a correlation between life expectancy and project. If you have a project for more than 20 years, you have much more chances not to die in the next 20 years. If you don't have projects for the next 20 years, you have less chance to survive in the next 20 years, whatever is your age. When you leave this room, think about what do I want to do in 20 years? Think about what do I want to do in 5 years in order to reach my goal in the next 20 years? Think about it. Think about it at least once a month. 5 minutes. Check. Write it. That's an healthy exercise. Difficult, but healthy. You may change your mind, of course. We all change our mind. But at least we have a goal. That's also true for companies, for universities. What this university want to be in 20 years? Do you have a plan for 2045? You should. You have. Excellent. I'll be happy to read it.
But it's hidden.
It should not.
No,
it's hidden. It should not. It should be open, it should be discussed, it should be changed every 5 years, it should be really clear, a project. And it should be true for each of us. It should be true for each company, even if we don't know that 2 years from now we'll change it. But at least we have a goal. Is there a plan for Italy in 2035? Of course not. It doesn't exist. It should. Do we have a plan for Europe 2035? It should. There is no way for Europe to survive. There is no way to organize growth in Europe if people have not a vision of Europe in 2035 in order for investors from around the world to say, yes, it's a place to come, because these guys, they have a vision for what they want to be. And then we want to invest for a long term with them. It's also true for companies, and it's why companies having family shareholders are more, strangely enough, the two more efficient, long-term oriented companies are companies with family shareholders and public ownership, because this is long-term. While worldwide, the average length of shareholding is used to be, 20 years ago, it was 6 months. Now it's something like 10 seconds as an average. Because of the techniques of in finance, which means that how do you want to make decisions on companies where shareholdings are having shares for less than 1 minute? That doesn't mind. That doesn't matter. It doesn't work. That's why one decision that should be taken by a nation is to say that the power of voting in a company should be higher if you have the shares for a longer period of time. The longer you have their shares, the more you have power to vote. That should influence gravely the influence of the evolution of this situation. In terms of politics, what should be important is to think about can we give a power to next generations? It's very difficult. Who can be said of, I speak on behalf of next generation? Who am I to say what next generation will think about it? There is one idea that could be used is to say, let's replace the Senate, which, by the way, in many countries we don't know what is used for, by a room or a house having as a mandate to speak on behalf of next generation. It will be a consultative house, but they will speak on behalf of next generation, and they will say, okay, if we were 30 years from now, what do we think of the law that we want to pass now? What will be the consequence in 20 years of what we want to do now? It will be very healthy if we do that. Some countries are thinking about it. By the way, City of Paris is creating a house of next generation that will be publicly announced next month, that will be doing exactly that, try to decide or make give an advice to the decision body in terms of what the next generation will think about it. By the way, it will be also interesting to see if something of the same kind can be done in a university where students may speak on behalf of next generation. But another issue. Thank you very much.